Okay, I think we're ready to start the next panel, if I can ask for your attention. My name is Philip Alston. I have the great misfortune, I mean good fortune, of having the opposite office to Jerry Cohen in this building. And so I am instructed from time to time about things that I will do, and here I am. It's a great pleasure. I have to say, I don't normally bother with this, but I have various United Nations capacities, and I have to say that I'm not here in any of those, but rather as a person oppressed by Jerry Cohen. That's my official capacity. So today we're talking about the refugee problem, international law, and China's role. Absolutely fascinating questions. We're going to start with Hyeonseo Lee, who is a refugee. She's listed as a refugee activist, but I think she is both a refugee and an activist, and is going to give us a real picture of what that means. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. From the moment I was born, I felt propaganda, and I viewed the Kim family dynasty not only as our fearless protectors from the imperialist forces, but also as gods. Growing up, I never thought our country's founder, Kim's son, could even go to the bathroom like us humans. It wasn't until age 14 when I watched his funeral, it was 1994, I realized that he was actually human. Until that moment, I thought our God couldn't die. Using elaborate deceptions as well as coercive tools of control, the North Korean leadership is able to indoctrinate and brainwash the vast of majorities, and depriving them their natural right to learn the truth about the outside world. Most people can't understand why North Korean people were crying after the former North Korean dictators Kim Il-sung and Kim Jong-il died, but those who grew up in North Korea, we completely understand that, because we first learn to say mom and dad when we are young children, and then we say thank you to our beloved leaders. Previously, when I thought they were gods, I didn't think it was strange, like just as eating three meals a day was normal for us. So I thought bowing to their pictures and singing their praises was also normal. And North Koreans are constantly inundated with anti-imperialist propaganda, especially for Americans. From the kindergarten, we learned that Americans are our primary enemies, who killed many innocent North Korean people during the Korean War. And even these days, North Koreans learn that Americans are colonizing South Korea and executing South Korean students. So our hostility towards Americans was so high, and we considered Americans are not as normal human beings. So those are the first people who must kill them off. And we also learned that British are considered gentlemen in North Korea, and Americans are considered as American bastards. But we never really learned why British are considered gentlemen. So therefore, you know, every schools in North Korea, we hang posters about killing American soldiers, and every year on Children's Day, we played a game about how to stab American soldiers. I also witnessed my first public execution when I was 7 years old. I was stunned to see a crowd gathered around a man hanging from a bridge. North Korean authorities want people to live in a constant state of fear, so they force us to watch public executions. So sometimes schools canceled their classes, so all the students could witness the public execution, and attendance was mandatory. Sometimes people even were executed for very minor offenses, such as a man who stole 1 kilogram of grain from the farm to feed his starving family. And North Korean authorities often imprisoned those who were trying to escape the country or make money in China to support their families back home. Yet the supposedly socialist system provides no support and forces people into a miserable life of poverty and hunger. Even though the people who saw the public execution were usually terrified, we accepted the public execution as a part of our lives automatically, since we didn't know anything about the concept of human rights. So the executions were a constant reminder that I shouldn't do anything to disobey my country, to our government. Ultimately, the biggest killer in North Korea is starvation, which has killed more than 1 million North Korean people. By mid-1995, I began to notice that people around me were suffering. In 1995, when I went to my friend's home during the lunchtime, I found the whole family had nothing to eat, but I didn't know why they didn't have anything to eat. But the following year, I read a letter from a woman about her whole family was dying because they didn't have any food for weeks, and they had no energy and no hope. So the 5 family members were lying on the floor together. They were waiting to die. This was the first time I heard that people in my country were suffering. And when I saw so many people were dying and begging on the street, I began to doubt that my country's propaganda that North Korea is the best in the world. We were always taught that capitalism was a sickness that would cause societal decay. But I didn't see how communism could be better when people dying and begging on the streets. Even our teachers had stopped teaching so they could earn money from the market. But still at that time, I didn't know that we were suffering due to our government-filled system. And I believed the regime's propaganda that we are only suffering because of Americans' sanctions. So I praised our leaders to protecting us and doing their best to us. But fortunately, information beyond the regime's control would soon help open my mind, because I lived right next to the Chinese border, and amazingly, all television could pick up a few Chinese TV channels. So as I watched secretly, and I became overwhelmed with the curiosity and full of dreams about the outside world. Although even watching TV was a problem because of constant power shortages. And at night, I was surrounded by darkness, poverty, and starvation. And I often gazed across the river at China's brilliant street lights and neon signs. And I gradually realized that my country is not the best in the world. I had been lied to all my life. So after this revelation, I was determined to leave North Korea to find out the truth about the outside world. For North Koreans to try to cross the border is a huge risk. And some people even die trying. And border guards were shot to kill, and I saw sometimes the dead bodies flowing down the river during the famine. But luckily, my family had some connections to the border guards in my area, so it wasn't hard for me to cross the border at all. And I thought I could quickly return from my journey to China, but I could have never imagined that it would take 14 years until I would see my family again. After arriving in China, I began to learn the truth about my country, and most importantly, I realized that a life of fear, hunger, and oppression is a crime against the North Korean people. Although I began to get a sense of freedom in China, I was also terrified since Chinese government were captured and repatriated North Koreans to a horrible fate back in North Korea. I couldn't go back to North Korea because of the rumor that I had defected, so I had to live with some distant relatives in China. After living 3 years of living under the radar, someone eventually reported me, so I was taken to the police station. So the interrogators were grilling me for a long time and asked me many difficult questions and forced me to read difficult Chinese newspapers. I acted calmly on the outside, but inside I felt like my heart was going to explode. If I failed to convince them that I was Chinese, my family and I would be in huge trouble. Thanks to the countless hours I spent studying on Chinese, at the time my Chinese language abilities were good enough to answer the questions and then read the papers. After what seemed like an eternity, one officer said to another, "This was a false report. She's not North Korean." And they let me go. Yeah, it was a truly miracle. After that, I just quickly decided to move to Shanghai since it's a big city without many North Korean defectors. So for the Chinese police, it would be difficult to find me. And then in there, I started new life again. And with all my hard work, I purchased the Chinese ID cards. And then later, I was able to get a job at a trading company. About 10 years of living and struggling in China, I decided that I wanted to see the differences between North Korean propaganda and the life in South Korea with my own eyes. So I got a visa to South Korea. In 2008, in South Korea's international airport, I asked for asylum. And soon, two officials approached me and they checked all my documents. And then they asked me with suspicious eyes, "Your Chinese passport and visa are real. Are you really a North Korean?" They thought I was a Chinese citizen impersonating North Korean to receive South Korean citizenship. So they warned me to go back to the Shanghai to the next airline, else I would receive strict punishment under the law and then be deported. I couldn't believe even in South Korea, I'm in danger of being repatriated to China and then to North Korea, where I might be tortured and publicly executed for visiting South Korea. So at that time, thoughts were racing through my mind, and was this all a huge mistake I made to come to South Korea? But after a long investigation in the National Intelligence Service, I was finally accepted as a North Korean citizen. And my first day as a North Korean citizen, it was hard for me to adjust another new life in South Korea. But I was still very thankful because at least I have a citizenship and a place to sleep and assistance from the government. In China, I started with nothing and I worked my way up, so I reassured myself I could overcome this difficult time. But settling down in South Korea was a lot more challenging than I had expected. Because North Koreans and South Koreans look similar on the outside, but inside we've changed due to more than 60 years of division. And throughout this time, our lifestyles, culture, even languages have become different. And North Koreans have to endure like prejudice and ice stares from some South Koreans. So in the end, I went to a serious identity crisis. And another surprising aspect of life in South Korea was that I had to face another language barrier since English is so important in South Korea. Anyway, I was lucky that I left North Korea and then eventually made it to South Korea, but millions of North Koreans are living inside virtual prison without even knowing about the truth, about the concept of human rights. Also, countless other North Korean women are suffering in China as they are forced into sexual slavery or sold as a prize. The North Korean human rights tragedy must become one of the international community's pressing issues. I'm very grateful for the growing support of North Korean human rights within the United Nations and the international organizations, but I think we need to do more. As free people of the world, we not only have a duty, but a moral obligation to lend a helping hand to North Korean refugees and to liberate the North Korean people from their shackles of oppression. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. The next speaker is Melanie Kirkpatrick, who worked for a long time for the Wall Street Journal. I don't know if you're a refugee from my compatriot Rupert Murdoch, or whether you were, whether you got out
no,
before
we're,
then.
We're comrades in arms.
Okay. Melanie has authored a book called Escape from North Korea, The Untold Story of Asia's Underground Railroad. Melanie.
Thank you. It's a delight to be here today, and what a hard act to follow, I must say. A very powerful presentation. It's a special privilege for me to be here today, too, because Tim Gelatt and I were friends. We worked in Hong Kong in the early 1980s, and I grew to like and respect his work enormously. So I feel honored to be here at this program in his memory. My assigned task this afternoon is to provide a brief overview of what happens to North Koreans who flee to China. I'll focus on the treatment of North Koreans in China as well as that of the people who help them. This is also the subject of my recent book, Escape from North Korea, The Untold Story of Asia's Underground Railroad. On China's role, let me say at the outset that that my conclusion accords with that of the recent United Nations Commission of Inquiry. China is complicit in North Korea's human rights abuses. In the words of Michael Kirby, the chairman of the commission, Beijing, quote, could be aiding and abetting crimes against humanity, unquote, by forcibly repatriating North Koreans who flee to that country, as well as by allowing North Korean security agents to operate on Chinese soil. These North Korean agents commit violence against North Koreans, they coerce them into spying on other North Koreans, and they kidnap them and take them back to North Korea. It's a very serious crime, as Hyeonseo noted, to escape, to leave the country without the regime's permission. It is also extremely dangerous. One of the first acts that Kim Jong-un took when he succeeded his father in December 2011 was to issue a shoot-to-kill order. Any North Korean spotted trying to cross the border was to be shot on sight. No questions asked. Michael Kirby has spoken about how human rights in North Korea have deteriorated since Kim Jong-un took over. This is just one example. A North Korean who wants to escape has little choice but to go, as Hyeonseo did, to China. A few high-ranking North Koreans have defected while traveling abroad. A few people have ordinary people have managed to get access to a boat and sail to the south. And once in a while a North Korean soldier is able to find his way across the heavily fortified border to the south. But for the vast majority of ordinary North Koreans who wish to leave their country, China is the only option. China has an 880-mile border with North Korea along the Yalu and Tumen rivers, which are fordable or swimmable or in winter often walkable. In China, most North Koreans, however, exchange one circle of hell for another. Unless he is lucky enough to meet up with humanitarians, usually Christian, or relatives who will help them, or unless he has enough money to hire a broker who will escort him out of China, the escaping North Korean has to go into hiding from the Chinese authorities. This is because China's policy is to track down, arrest, and repatriate North Koreans. Since the late 1990s, Beijing has returned thousands of North Korean refugees to North Korea. The fate of North Koreans whom Beijing repatriates is horrific. Prison time is a given, usually in a local detention center. The conditions in the detention centers, by the way, are not much better than those we hear about in the political prisons or in the labor re-education camps. The prisoners are subject to torture, they are forced to work long hours at hard labor, they are given very little to eat, and they have no access to medical facilities. Repatriated North Koreans who are suspected of having met with Christians, North Koreans, or Americans while in China face especially harsh treatment, such as severe torture, transfer to political prison camps, or even execution. China typically sends dossiers with the North Koreans they repatriate, and the dossier can contain information that will doom the returned North Korean to special punishment. I once heard the story of a Chinese prison guard who showed kindness to a teenage boy who was about to be repatriated by allowing him to, of all things, cut his hair, which had grown long while he was hiding in China. The long hair was a giveaway that the boy had been in China for several months or more. His newly shortened hair, however, allowed him to argue to the North Korean authorities that he had just been in China a couple of days, was planning to go back, and hadn't contacted any so-called subversive forces. A pregnant woman who is repatriated faces a special set of horrors. North Korea either forces her to undergo an abortion, or if the baby is allowed to be born, he or she is killed. The method of murder varies. The infant can be hit on the head, drowned in a bucket, smothered with a rag, or left out in the elements to die. I've heard reports of all such killing techniques. Why is the child killed? It's because North Korea presumes that the father is Chinese, which North Korea's regime considers to be bad seed. In the regime's racist view, the child is contaminated by his mixed blood. He or she is impure. Beijing likes to defend its repatriation policy by comparing it with the U.S. policy on Mexicans who enter, Central Americans who enter this country illegally. This is absurd. Mexico does not imprison, torture, or execute citizens whom the U.S. sends back. The majority of the North Koreans who flee to China are women. One reason for that is that there is a market for North Korean women in China. Some of the women find jobs as prostitutes or as internet porn workers. Others are forced into sexual slavery as the so-called brides of Chinese men. Because of China's long-standing one-child policy, there is a shortage of young women in northeast China. And brokers have even set up businesses that allow men to order a bride from North Korea. Sometimes the bride is identified in North Korea and tricked into crossing the border to China. Other times, she is spotted by lookouts on the Chinese side of the frontier who are paid by the bride brokers to alert them when a pretty girl shows up. I should note that some of these marriages are successful, and the North Korean brides sometimes are happy to stay with their husbands in China. But they are never safe. They are always at the risk of arrest and repatriation if the local authorities become aware of their existence. Husbands will pay bribes to local policemen not to arrest their North Korean wives. Some of the North Koreans who are hiding in China attempt yet another escape to South Korea. No North Korean can accomplish this on his own. The distances across China are too great. The North Korean rarely speaks Chinese or knows how to operate in Chinese society without being identified as from the North. The risk of arrest, in short, is too high, usually, to go it alone. And this is where the Underground Railroad comes in. Like the original Underground Railroad that helped American slaves reach safety in the North or Canada, the Underground Railroad in China is a network of secret routes across China and safe houses. Many of the operators are Christians, both local Chinese Christians as well as Christians from South Korea, the US, Canada, or elsewhere. Brokers, human traffickers, also do a big business along the Underground Railroad. The usual route of the Underground Railroad covers 2,000 or 3,000 miles across China to a bordering country in Southeast Asia, Burma, Laos, Vietnam. Another route goes north to Mongolia. Occasionally, a North Korean with enough money can purchase false or, in Hyeonseo's cases, true Chinese documents or South Korean documents and travel out of the country by plane or ship. Once a North Korean is out of China, he will go to a South Korean embassy or consulate and ask for help. Under the South's constitution, every North Korean is entitled to live in the South. North Koreans may be the only refugees anywhere in the world with a guaranteed home. 10 or so years ago, North Koreans could seek assistance in foreign embassies or consulates in China itself. But that option is far more difficult today, as the Chinese have caught on and they have vastly increased the number of checkpoints around consular facilities, and a North Korean would be arrested before he even reached the front door. Some of the Christians working underground in China dedicate their efforts to helping North Koreans actually stay in China. They run safe houses, for example, where North Koreans can hide. They help North Koreans learn to pass as Chinese. They find them new clothes. They teach women how to apply makeup. They teach them the Chinese language and so forth. The humanitarians will also purchase forged identity documents for the North Koreans in their care so that they can get proper jobs, attend school if they are children, receive medical care, and otherwise be integrated into Chinese society. Just as the Fugitive Slave Act in the United States made it a crime anywhere in America to help a slave who had escaped from his masters, so too in China today it is a crime to help North Koreans. I know of a woman, the wife of a Chinese pastor, who spent 2 years in jail for purchasing train tickets for refugees. Several Americans have gone to jail for helping North Koreans, including a businessman from Long Island who had offered food, shelter, and money to North Koreans who were hiding there. Let me close by quoting an American whose organization operates safe houses for women and children in China. He recently emailed me about the current situation in China for North Koreans and those who helped them. China, he told me, has dramatically tightened security in the border area. He also mentioned several foreigners who have been under house arrest in China for several months. Finally, he mentioned what he called a new hazard to North Korean women who are hiding in China. And here I'll read directly from his email. He writes, quote, "President Xi's new anti-corruption drive includes removing many senior police officers from positions they've settled into over time. Suddenly, new appointments are upending bribe arrangements, as intended, of course, but some of these payoffs are by husbands of North Korean women who are trying to keep the mothers of their children safe. When the new police come in, new amounts are sometimes being demanded for the new policemen, and such bribe gouging is beyond the reach of some of these poor households. Some of the mothers and children we're helping out of China right now are desperate because they are unable to pay the new police bribes, and the Chinese father of these children are agreeing that there's no option but for the women and children in some cases to flee." That, ladies and gentlemen, is the reality of life for North Koreans in China today. Thank you.
Thank you, Melanie. This is a very cheery panel. Maybe the light relief will now come from the lawyer. Roberta Cohen has a very long and extraordinarily distinguished career in the human rights field and is currently with the Brookings Institution. She's going to talk about the international law ramifications of China's repatriation or refoulement policy.
Thank you, Philip. I want to thank Jerry Cohen for initiating the program, and I've long admired your work with Chinese lawyers and Chinese dissidents. I've been asked to focus on the legal aspects of this question in honor of Timothy Gelatt, but I have to say that I am not a lawyer, but I've learned in life that everybody does their bit. I'd like to begin my remarks with a conversation I had a number of years ago with the Chinese ambassador in Washington. He told me that North Koreans who cross the border illegally into China are economic migrants. They're not refugees, and they must be returned to their country, even though there was no screening process to make a determination. That viewpoint remains China's policy today, and over the past two decades, China has return tens of thousands of North Koreans who are severely punished on return, as Melanie has described, because it's a criminal offense to leave North Korea without permission. China's approach raises a number of questions I'd like to address. The first is whether North Koreans crossing the border should be considered refugees. The answer, in my opinion, should be yes. They are refugees sur place. That's a special term. It means that no matter what their particular reason was for leaving North Korea, they become refugees because they have a well-founded fear of persecution upon return. The United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, Antonio Guterres, has called the North Koreans in China refugees sur place, in need of international protection. At the same time, there might be quite a number of North Koreans crossing the border directly fleeing political persecution. Of the 27,000 North Koreans who've managed to make their way to South Korea, hundreds were former prisoners. And they testified before the UN that they fled because they were under surveillance, discrimination, also persecution, after their release. Another factor to consider is North Koreans' sangbun, social stratification system. Every North Korean is assigned a sangbun status based on their family's political loyalty. And this can go back generations. Those of low sangbun generally suffer socioeconomic deprivation. Thus, some of those crossing into China for economic reasons may well be in that situation because of political persecution. The second question that arises is whether China is violating international law. And again, the answer should be yes. The UN High Commissioner for Refugees has directly told China that forcibly returning North Koreans without any screening process to determine whether they need asylum is a violation of the 1951 Refugee Convention, which China has signed. United Nations human rights treaty bodies, these are the bodies that review states' implementation of the provisions and laws that they have ratified. And the Committee Against Torture, the Committee on the Rights of the Child, the Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination in Women, have all called on China to bring its practices into line with the provisions of the international treaties which China has ratified. The Torture Convention, for example, prohibits governments from returning persons to a country where they might be subject to torture. This year, the UN Commission of Inquiry into Human Rights in North Korea produced a 400-page report that also looked at China's practices because these could enable violations in North Korea. And the report found China to be violating international human rights law, refugee law, and also customary law by forcibly returning North Koreans to conditions of danger where their lives and freedom would be threatened. And also by sharing information, as Melanie has described, with North Korea's security bodies in hunting down North Koreans. In a special letter to China, the Commission's chair, Michael Kirby, cautioned China that it could be aiding and abetting crimes against humanity being perpetrated by North Korea against those repatriated by China. I would note that the Commission chair is a distinguished former High Court Justice of Australia, and that that's Michael Kirby, and that one of the members of the Commission, Marzuki Darusman, was the former Attorney General of Indonesia. The report called upon China to cease forced returns and also provide protection to North Koreans, especially women who were hiding in China and who were vulnerable to trafficking, forced marriage, and to protect children born of half-Chinese parents who were denied legal residence status. The third question I would ask is, what is China's response based on? Now, from a legal perspective, China appears to be arguing that its national law has primacy over international law. Its law on entry and exit, which is the most recent one coming into force in 2013, criminalizes illegal border crossing and requires Chinese citizens, companies, and other entities to report foreigners who illegally enter to local security officials. Michael Kirby has commented that, quote, there is an inherent inconsistency between the espoused commitment of China to the rule of law nationally, but an indifference to the requirements of the rule of law internationally. The rule of law also applies to international law. Now, for the first time, China's new law on entry and exit contains a provision on refugees, which refers to screening processes and says that foreigners identified as refugees may remain and reside in China with special certificates. That may show some effort to try to reconcile national and international law, but China hasn't moved yet to set up the machinery to implement the law and hasn't applied the provision to North Koreans. When it comes to North Koreans, China has a special agreement with North Korea. It dates back to 1986, even earlier, to the 60s, and that agreement views persons crossing into the other's territory without permission as criminals, about whom information is to be shared and who are to be deported, and China gives this agreement primacy over its international obligations. In practice, China has on occasion allowed small groups of North Koreans who escaped into foreign embassies or consulates or were in the UNHCR compound to go on to South Korea. And sometimes China has allowed North Koreans whose cases are raised with China's president by South Korea's president to also go on to South Korea. But these are small numbers, and they don't change China's fundamental policy of preserving what it calls stability on the Korean Peninsula. As North Koreans' protector in this, it has feared that if it were to stop deporting North Koreans, more and more would try to leave, and that in time the outflow could destabilize North Korea. This then leads to my final question: how do we go forward? And that's the hardest question to answer. Let me put forward a few options, not that any would be easy to implement. First, governments need to get behind UNHCR, the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, in pressing for a moratorium on forced repatriations, access to the border, and a special humanitarian protection status for North Koreans. And since China regularly urges constructive dialogue in order to deal with human rights differences, why not have a dialogue to be set up by UNHCR with China, or a mutually agreed government to call it? Its purpose would be to develop a multilateral plan for dealing with the refugee situation and to stop repatriations. Second, it would be important for the United States and South Korea to regularly and repeatedly raise the issue in their bilateral relations and get other countries to do likewise. South Korea has been able to influence China to let some North Koreans go to the South. The United States should also, in their discussions with China, try to address the issue of stability, solutions for refugee flows, and try to ease China's fears about expanding U.S. influence on the Korean Peninsula. Third, General Assembly resolutions should begin to mention China. At present, resolutions on North Korea call on all states to stop repatriating North Koreans, even though China is the principal perpetrator, and its practices influence other states to do likewise. In addition, the UN is setting up an office in Seoul to monitor North Korea's human rights situation, and it ought to document China's forced repatriation of the North Koreans, just like the Commission of Inquiry did, and begin to identify the institutions and the individuals involved with a view to accountability. If the General Assembly, which is now meeting, refers the case of North Korea to the Security Council, then discussions could take place that involve the refugee issue in the Council. If the Commission of Inquiry report is to be taken seriously, then governments and international organizations must encourage China to consider a new approach and to find ways to see it in China's interests to develop a new approach. Thank you.
Thanks, Roberta. Just one very quick comment to say that we have actually come a long way. Although it's a long time, I still have a vivid memory. In the late 1980s, I was a member of one of these UN human rights bodies, and the delegation of the Democratic People's Republic appeared before the committee, and the opening line of the delegation was the DPRK is a paradise on earth, and then went on to say, and we are proud to announce that there are no human rights problems. The relevance of that is not the ridiculousness of the claim, but that at the time, as a member of that committee, we had access to extraordinarily little information with which to contradict what were obviously ludicrous claims. And I remember well having to say to the delegation at a certain point, look, I don't have specific information to contrast what you're saying, but I have to tell you that nothing that you have said resonates in any way with what I still understand to be the situation in your country. But that was the best I could do. So we've come rather a long way with Michael Kirby's 400-page, very systematic and carefully argued indictment of the regime. We're open to questions to any or all of the panelists. Yes. Down the front. There's a microphone coming. Ambassador Lord.
Winston Lord, a member of the HRNK board. My question's for Ms. Lee, and that is South Korea's treatment of North Korean refugees and defectors. How enlightened is it? Is it improving? And what could be done better?
I arrived in South Korea in 2008. At the time, it's been 6 years so far. It's improving because at the time, through my experience, I can explain, in the taxi, the taxi driver, if asked me, are your pronunciation something different? Where are you from? He if asked me, and I says, I'm from North Korea. And then he just became completely silent. He didn't say any word. I became alien at the time. But over the time, there's a North Korean woman's talk show, and then there's a lot of North Koreans also giving talk through the media, giving interviews, telling their stories. So even in South Korea, the people's perspective is just changing, you know? So the other time, maybe last year when I was in the taxi again, I said, I'm from North Korea, and then the taxi driver was so excited, wow, I saw the TV, you know, the situations, and then he's keep talking with me about that. So yeah, it's improving the situation. I'm just really happy for that, but still, because we were divided more than 60 years of division, so still we need more time to close the gap, yeah.
Good, thank you. Yes.
I have a question for Ms. Cohen.
Yuzhe, do you want to use this?
Sure.
I have a question for Ms. Cohen. So you mentioned that there have been various treaty bodies that have condemned China for violating international law by sharing information with North Korea and sending back refugees. Have these techniques been effective? And I assume their condemnation hasn't been very effective, otherwise we wouldn't see the current situation. So how would your proposal of the four approaches of engaging China be different from the current methods that UN and the world community is using?
The treaty bodies at the UN really hold their meetings in it's very quiet. These are not bodies that usually, sometimes, but usually come out with big statements. But China has had to come before this group of experts and have had to explain their policies. Has it changed anything? First of all, it's the only place that holds China specifically to account within the UN system. I did mention that China's law that came into force in 2013 for the first time has a provision on refugees. So that is something that, although not yet implemented, and we don't know whether it will be in the case of North Koreans, the machinery has not been set up, but it's a place to build. So I think that is a development that's worth looking at and getting behind UNHCR, which I believe guided some of the drafting of that paragraph, in trying to get China to actually implement it. As for the other points to be made, I think as Phil Alston pointed out, the Commission of Inquiry report has been a bit of a game changer because it took the decision that it wouldn't only focus on North Korea. That was its mandate. It included in its mandate China, because it saw that what China was doing was enabling North Korea in committing crimes against humanity when North Koreans were returned. And so this letter from Kirby to the Chinese ambassador warning that its officials were aiding or abetting crimes against humanity has put a different cast, and I think that China's reputation is on the line in this. Now, many will argue, oh, they don't care. But I don't think an emerging power like that particularly likes to have it right in the newspapers everywhere that this Commission of Inquiry report has found China to be aiding, abetting, and there are long paragraphs on China in this. It really goes to town with information and also challenges every argument that's been made by China. So China's continuing to say these are economic migrants, they're not punished on return, is increasingly challenged and shown by witness testimony and other information that this is not true. So I think there is something to the embarrassment factor that has developed. Another point that I would just make is that China's relationships with South Korea have been improving, and South Korea has been raising the issue, and the idea perhaps of, and maybe I'm taking a lot of leaps here, but the idea of South Korea's leading a reunification of Korea and not necessarily being something that isn't of China's interests, in other words, that it can be reconciled as something in China's interests, begins to just at least be talked about here or there. How it's certainly nowhere is near there. But that also, because I think China, it would certainly ease China's discomfort with right now what it has to do. It has to keep lying about these issues, which it really is doing. And it has to keep being embarrassed and having its reputation tarnished. And is the stability that it's supposedly supporting, is it really firm? Is North Korea, how stable is it? Do you want to be known as the defender of a government that has now been said its human rights record has no parallel in the contemporary world?
Yes, Liz Wickery.
Hi, Liz Wickery from the Leitner Center for International Law and Justice at Fordham. We're actually coming out with a report. Thanks for talking to me earlier this week, Roberta. So I look forward to sharing that. I have a question on a slightly different topic, maybe best for Melanie, which is, to what extent do we know about the policing in the border areas between China and North Korea, and whether or not the presence of policing and security forces has increased at all in line with the change in policy on the North Korean side for shoot-to-kill orders, for example. I've done some research on increases in policing in other border regions of China, and so the statistics are there. I'm just wondering if you or if you've done any of that research, or if you know of you know, how that's changed, whether it's changed, you know, how many resources are put into that.
Well, the reports from North Korea given to researchers or journalists in China have said that Kim Jong-un has increased security dramatically. He's made it, there's much more punishment of border guards who accept bribes or look the other way and allow North Koreans to leave. We know that there are villages along the river on the North Korean side that have been closed and the people have been empty. This is, we presume, because they are a jumping off point to crossing the border. So if you close the villages and nobody can go there, that's a way to deter people from crossing. There have also been cameras that have been set up along the border where it hasn't been the case in the past. Before, you would see pictures occasionally or hear reports of man pits, kind of like you used to see in the Tarzan movies, where people who were crossing the border might step and be captured. But now they're motion sensor cameras. On the Chinese side of the border, there are also reports of much more military activity now, and there are walls that have been built or are in the process of being built in certain areas where the crossings have been more frequent.
Jerry Cohen, and then Kwan.
Oh, thank you. This is a terrific discussion, and it does what I had hoped would be accomplished, focus on China's responsibility here. And in a way, it's simpler than many international law questions. It's simply a question of fact. Has the Chinese government set up the machinery to interview these migrants to determine what's their appropriate status, as you say? And I wonder several things. Do we know much about how China has treated migrants from Southeast Asia, especially Burma and Vietnam? And is there a difference there? And does the United States, in treating people who come from Mexico, whether Mexican or otherwise, establish machinery to interview them? Or do we too, without regard to what you do about it, if they're not human rights people, do we have machinery for interviewing the people who come to us?
I'll desist from making a totally political comment, Jerry, but I would just say that Roberta cited Michael Kirby as talking about the rule of law applying domestically and internationally. Michael Kirby, like me, comes from Australia. Australia's refugee policies these days are to make sure that no one gets into the country, to interdict them outside the country and then send them quickly as possible either to Cambodia, where they have no links at all, or often enough back to the country from which they fled. So it's worth emphasizing the implication of your question, which is that the hypocrisy of other governments disarms them to some extent in being able to fully criticize and hold China to account. but I'd ask Melanie and perhaps
just one very Roberta. Quick comment. I take your point, and those are questions that deserve to be considered, but it completely ignores the moral questions here, which is the treatment of North Koreans who are repatriated. And I thought that Roberta's description of the difference between a refugee and a refugee surplus, was, is an effective distinction.
Let me just first mention, Jerry, that as far as we know, China does treat others differently from the North Koreans. China has been cooperating with UNHCR with regard to minorities that are in China who've come from Laos and Vietnam, including Han Chinese, and looking how to integrate them even into China. And they've allowed UNHCR access to those who come in from Pakistan, Eritrea, Iraq, and other places, and they have access to them and to being screened. UNHCR has determined some to be refugees or whatever. So there's a very sharp differentiation between how they treat North Koreans and how they treat the others. And so this is something that is one should has to study.
Is there a known explanation of that difference?
China just insists, it's obviously on political grounds, that prima facie economic migrants, these, we don't even have to screen them. So there is no screening when it comes to North Koreans. They don't allow UNHCR to the border. It's quite arbitrary, really. And I think it's quite politically based from what we can see. The question, though, I did want to also add to what Melanie said, and partly an answer also to the moderator, is that I don't know of another situation where a person is not allowed to leave their country, where it's a criminal offense to leave the country at this time. And maybe there are a few countries like that. But in this case, if that's a criminal offense, then every single person who is going to be returned is going to be punished. It's and that return, therefore, leads to a punishment of the person, a persecution of the person, and their return to a situation of definite danger. So I think that this is something that is quite striking about this situation. And there's no screening of any kind when it comes to the North Koreans. There is screening in other situations. United States, yes, there is screening. Human rights organizations will call for more screening, but there has been screening with regard to the Central Americans. I don't think these are comparable cases. I think you have to see this case for what it is, and also look at what are better humane solutions in Central America, Australia, or wherever. But I think this is a rather unique and cruel case that we have to take a look at. And I would say that there is no media, there's no NGOs, there's no UNHCR, there's no way that you're going to get right now within China that kind of response. In the United States, you have all these organizations rushing, and all the media and the UN. What is the U.S. doing on this border? So, and the U.S. considers, should we change procedures? It's discussed in Congress. I mean, it's an open question. Here we're talking about something that's quite cruel and secretive, and I think it shouldn't be compared with other situations as such.
Roberta, very, very quickly, is it not an offense to leave without authorization or whatever, leave through proper channels Sri Lanka?
I couldn't answer you about Sri Lanka. I've been there several times, but I don't
right.
know
You've
exactly.
Been allowed to leave.
Yeah, I
yeah.
don't know that.
Because that's where Australia has returned quite a few people to Sri Lanka, and there is pretty good evidence that they are then punished fairly significantly for having left the country, but I'm not sure what the domestic legal situation is. but I can check that. Mm-hmm. Yes, in the back there.
My name is Kwan Hyung, an LLM student here at NIU from South Korea. I have some questions to Hyeonseo. I just want to know, it has been reported that many people in North Korea, including those who were repatriated from China, have been arrested and sent to political prison camps, and severe human rights violations are being committed in those prison camps. So do ordinary North Korean citizens know about those human rights violations in those prison camps? And what do they think of the inmates? Do they think they are betrayers to their regime or the martyrs who have sacrificed their lives? And my second question, sorry, is that one of the biggest concerns that South Koreans have in mind in case of the regime collapse in North Korea is the possibility of annexation of North Korea by China. So in this context, what would be the reaction of ordinary North Korean citizens towards China?
First of all, in terms of prison camp in North Korea, we don't have the world's prison camp in North Korea. We call it Gwalliseo. I don't know, how can I explain this in English? And we have several different prison, like a political prison camp, labor camp, something like that. And people really, we are being scared of being sent to the political prison camp because, you know, why? We don't know what's happening inside there exactly. We know there's some prison camp we have existed, but we don't know what's happening there exactly. And but one thing we knew, if somebody is sent inside there, they can't get out of there forever, even after they died. That's why we just being scared to send there. And then my mom always, I remember like when I was young, she told me many times, like, be careful what you are saying in the outside. Don't repeat any words what you hear at home. The words have ears and the fears have eyes. So whenever she said that, I just tend to look at the world. And I believed as a young girl that people can hear through the world. The reason why we were so scared of that, because of to not send to prison camp, we need to be careful about what we are saying. But the North Korean refugees who were sent inside North Korea, not that many refugees sent into prison camp, but those who were trying to escape to South Korea, those people was severely treated in North Korea, maybe prison, public execution and prison camp. But those people who was caught in China, just in normal situation, they are like living in prison 1 year or 6 months and then will be returned to their homes. And yeah, many people saw the public execution who were executed for visiting South Korea, but not all North Koreans, but many North Koreans do believe they are betrayer. Because when I left North Korea, also my family was suffered because of the situation. Like I was betrayer in North Koreans' perspective, so they were watched by the government or like informants or snitches all the time. Like 15 years, they were watched. So yeah, on seeing the public execution, we just. Yeah, there. Some people have a sympathy because, but North Koreans are ignorant about what's going on in the outside world. So when we see the public execution, it's since their betrayal, it's deserved to die, which I thought in the past too. But yeah, really recent current situation in North Korea, I don't know, but I don't think it changed a lot compared to in the past. I forgot the second question.
Question of annexation of the North by China in the event of the fall of the government. how people in North Korea feel about that? In other words, would it be worse to be annexed by China than to be made part of China?
If North Korea were made part of China, what would the North Korean people?
I think in terms of the question, actually many North Koreans want to belong to China rather than South Korea. In the past, we wanted to have reunification. When I was growing up, we sang every day about reunification because we thought South Koreans are suffering under the American system, under the colonizing. So that's why we wanted to save South Korean people. That's why we wanted to have reunification. But over the time, because of the outside information flow into North Korea through the river, you know, the South Korean dramas, movies, or USB something, music. And then after saw that, people they knew that South Koreans are richer than North Korea right now. But through that time, through famine, because we survived with China, because we only can have relationship with China during that time. So from North Korean's perspective, Chinese are a savior than the Kim Il-sung or Kim Jong-il. So people, even though they don't speak, openly, but they inside, they want belong to China. But also some people want to have reunification under the South Korean system, but many of them who has a specific good relationship with China actually having good relations with China or belong to China is better than have that situation right now in North Korea. That's the perspective of North Koreans.
Good. Thank you very much. I want to thank all three speakers on the panel for a great session.